Okay, is this on? Thank you for the introduction. So indeed, we attended Machine Learning Summer School together in 2007. This was in Tübingen, which is, among other things, Bernard is from. And one thing that I noticed as I try to find this group photo is how awful the resolution of photos was back in 2007. So this is me, and then McCallery is probably somewhere here, but then maybe somewhere at the back. We couldn't exactly figure this out. The reason I'm showing you this is because there are other people on this group photo who are now, you know, professor at UBC, Mark Schmidt or Sarah Mostafavi. There is Sinead somewhere, Sinead Williamson, who's a professor at University of Texas. There's Joao Grassa, who's a founder of a very successful machine translation startup. So just to kind of hammer home the message that the people who are around you are, many of them are going to go on and have successful and long careers in machine learning, and hopefully yourself included. So one of the things that I got from this machine learning summer school is all the relationships that I built and all the friendships that I built. And actually, I signed up to Facebook in 2007 just to kind of keep in touch with those friends from the summer school. And this is the first time that I'm actually a speaker at a machine learning summer school. And the reason why this happened is that I kept complaining to people how they don't invite me to give talks. So I think that all that complaining has finally come to fruition. So before I go into the outline, this is also a talk about causality. And Bernard already gave talks about causality. I successfully sabotaged the projector so that his presentation was not working initially. There is going to be a lot of overlaps. So I'm going to go through some of the same material, but I'm going to use my own language to describe them. And these are difficult things to understand. If you already understand do calculus and counterfactuals, you're welcome to like go outside and have a rest and prepare for the other presentations. The way I think about Bernard's presentations versus mine is Bernard presented it from a very mathematical lens. So if you come to machine learning from a statistics background or maybe physics, Bernard's explanations might make more sense to you. And I wanted to create an introduction to causality as part of these talks that speaks to the people who come more from an engineering background, people who might have done a lot of TensorFlow and deep learning, but they might be a little bit uncomfortable or just inexperienced with working with mathematical notation. So my slides are going to be light on mathematical notation, and it might even annoy mathematicians because I might say things that are imprecise. But I do this to make sure that people get the main messages. So I'm hoping it's not going to be too repetitive and too boring. Stop me if it's too boring. Tell me to go away or tell me to slow it down if it's not slow enough. So the outline is, today I'm planning to give you some high-level motivations. And I work at Twitter, and I don't know if you knew this, if you worked 2 years here, you're only ever going to talk in hashtags. So the first couple slides are going to be a couple hashtags that are my ideas and my motivations for why I encourage you all to take causal inference seriously and try to get into it a little bit. And then I'm going to go through some very basic cases. Bernard mentioned a couple of these, the Simpson's paradox. He suggested that you go and read up about it. So I actually have that example that he described in words. I have some numbers, and I have like a full story around Simpson's paradox and a bunch of other things. And once I cover those basic cases, I will then talk about two of the main things that you want to do with causal inference. And this follows the Julia Pearl style of causal inference. So the first thing that we are going to do are interventions and do calculus. How do you predict how the system behaves under certain interventions? And then counterfactuals are these difficult things that, as David Bly mentioned, are a little bit difficult to wrap your head around at first. And so, as this was mentioned on the panel, I wasn't going to talk about counterfactuals, but because he mentioned how difficult it is to understand, I kind of went, okay, challenge accepted. I'm gonna have to try and explain counterfactuals to people. So let's see how it goes. This is sort of a new way that I started thinking about counterfactuals, and I think it's a good way to explain what they are. And then I don't know how far I'm going to go. It may be that counterfactuals are left for tomorrow. Tomorrow is a terrible day for me because it's the last lecture of the whole week, and then we do the practical on causal inference, and then we go to a wine estate and all drink wine. So no one's going to remember anything that I say tomorrow. So I basically just have a bunch of random topics, knowing that nobody's going to remember. But I'm going to talk about practical uses of causal inference, and specifically in the topic that I work on, which is online recommender systems and online advertising. So I'm going to talk about this concept of offline A/B testing, this other thing called counterfactual risk minimization, which has little to do with these counterfactuals. It's an overused term. And then there's going to be the practical with some toy examples in Python that you can play around with. I was hoping that you will be able to work with me on these toy examples, but the Wi-Fi is not great, and it's on Colab. So if the Wi-Fi doesn't work, then I'm just going to work through those toy examples here, and then you can take them home and complete them at home if you can't follow along because of the Wi-Fi. All right, so up to the hashtags. The first motivation is, I wanted to talk about this, and I talked about it a little bit at the panel, is that causal inference was a bit of a blind spot for me. So back in 2007, when we did the machine learning summer school, I actually checked this. There were 0.4 lectures on causal inference, which means that there was one lecture that touched on causal inference kind of as a side topic. It was around how to use kernel-based measures, kernel-based metrics for independence, and it turns out you can also use them in the context of causal inference. And this is not just the summer school, and that summer school was amazing, just like this one. We covered all the topics from Bayesian nonparametrics, Gaussian processes, kernels, convex optimization, all the hot topics of the time. And then I went on to do my PhD, and even in my PhD, causal inference was not something that we ever really seriously thought about. And then I went on to do my work as a data scientist, and I continued to ignore this topic. Of course, I knew that correlation doesn't equal causality, or whatever that kind of cliche that everybody repeats. You can find that even apparently in romantic novels these days, this quote. But I didn't really truly appreciate the significance of it and what you can actually do in practical terms with causal inference. So what changed this, as I said in the panel, is Judy O'Pearl published this book. He published a lot of books on causal inference, and I find that Judy O'Pearl's older books on causal inference are those books which are always on your reading list. You're always, at some point, going to do a reading group on it, but nobody ever dares actually starting because they are sort of so dense and so mathematical, and it's kind of a little bit scary. And so Judiana wrote this book, The Book of Why, and he wrote it together with Dana McKenzie, who's experienced in how to present complex scientific ideas to non-experts. And this was a wonderful combination, I think. The Book of Why is something that I read after I understood causal inference, to be fair, and then it was great. I'm not sure if you're completely new to the space, is this the best book, or is this a sufficient book to get you interested in the space, but at least it's a much better thing than anything that existed before. And along with this book, he then had this slightly controversial interview in which he said, all the impressive achievements of deep learning amount to just curve fitting. And this was discussed a lot on social media. A lot of machine learning people kind of took offense. And I said, okay, if someone smart like Judy O'Pearl says this, maybe I should go and understand what he means, because I didn't understand what he means by this. And so I spent a couple days reading about it, and eventually I understood it, and I wrote this blog post, MLB on Curve Fitting, an Intro to Causal Inference and Do Calculus. And this was, I do a lot of blog posts. This was a very successful one. Like, a lot of people read it, and a lot of people gave good feedback on it, including Judy O'Pearl himself, which was actually quite fun when I saw his email in my inbox. And this is what really got me started in causal inference. I've been reading about this a long time, but I'm not an expert. You know, don't expect me to be able to answer all your questions. I expect that many people in the audience who have worked on this before will know a lot more about causal inference than I do. What I'm hoping to do is convey the learnings that I had over the last couple months in a way that hopefully resonates with you as well. So I consider that despite its importance, causal inference has been a blind spot for many people, and I've seen other people that I consider very smart also just getting into causal inference and having ignored it previously. So this is a good time for you to also get into it. Having understood what it is, I now consider it basic hygiene. Basic hygiene in the sense that I consider thinking about overfitting and doing cross-validation is kind of basic hygiene. If you do machine learning, you have to understand what overfitting is. And I think that if you do machine learning, especially in critical domains such as healthcare or any time when you make decisions that affect, for example, in social media or internet companies, hundreds of millions of people, that's a critical application of machine learning. You kind of have to understand a little bit of causal thinking to make sure that you're not making very big mistakes. The other aspect that I wanted to say is that this is not rocket science. It's difficult to get into because all of the material out there, a lot of the material is very mathematical and it seems like it's difficult to understand. But the main concepts are actually not that complicated. And if you develop an intuition about it, you will find that it's not fundamentally a lot more complicated than a lot of other things that we already do in machine learning. So just to kind of encourage you that this is not something that won't happen. Another thing, which is a misconception I had, is causal inference is very important to healthcare. It's literally a life and death situation. You know, if you get this wrong and then your decision-making system recommends the wrong treatment to the wrong patient, the consequences are very clearly, could be very bad. And therefore, there is this correlation out there that when people talk about causal inference, it's often associated with healthcare applications. So at least I had this misconception is that if you work in healthcare, you have to think about causal inference, but I don't work on healthcare, so I'm fine. And I don't want you guys to have this association, so this is why I'm talking about online advertising and recommender systems, partly to make sure that I'm not just giving you healthcare examples, so you don't learn that association with healthcare. Final thing, this is kind of meaningless in itself, it's not either or. When this whole conversation about what is the importance of causal inference in AI started out, a lot of people argued as if it was, do you do deep learning or do you do causal inference? Like, I'm a deep learning researcher, I'm not a causal inference person. Or I do causal inference, I don't do deep learning. And this is not great. Deep learning specifically, or machine learning and causal inference often address orthogonal aspects of the problem. So there is no reason why you shouldn't think about both at the same time. If you do causal inference, at the end of the day, you arrive at something that you need to estimate, and it may be that deep learning is the best way to estimate that thing. And vice versa, if you do deep learning, if you haven't thought about the causal structure of your problem, no matter how big your deep learning model gets, if you estimate the wrong thing with it, you're just going to get better at answering the wrong question. So, you know, it's not like if you're a deep learning person, you don't have to think about it, and vice versa. Yeah, so it should be and can be combined with deep learning, and there's a lot of work. In fact, I met someone in the audience who's worked on combining deep learning with the method of instrumental variables, which is a particular thing that I'm not going to talk about here. Okay, so these are the five things that are my motivations for giving this talk, is that it's been a blind spot for me. I don't want it to be a blind spot for you. I consider it basic hygiene, and this is why I think it's important that everybody has a chance to get into it. It's not that difficult. It's not just healthcare, and it can and should be combined with deep learning. Stop me if you have any questions or anything or comments. So, roughly when we work with causal inference, we can ask these three kinds of questions that have increasing difficulty. And as we will see, you will need more and more assumptions and more tools in order to answer these more and more complex questions. So, what we normally look at in most of the machine learning, let's say supervised learning, when I'm trying to predict Y from X, are essentially observational questions. which is the question, do people who are given a drug, do they have a tendency to recover? What is the probability of recovery in patients where I see they took the drug? But as I'm pretty sure that at least this basic example is very clear to you now, this in itself may not mean that the drug is useful. It may just mean that, for example, it may be that the drug is expensive, so people who have a lot of money tend to buy this drug, but then people who have a lot of money also have access to better healthcare anyway, so they also tend to recover better. So these observational questions are interesting in some situations, but they won't be able to answer something else. This question which I ask, which is this drug useful for recovery, is in the second set of questions. These are intervention questions or action questions. If I give people this drug, how likely is it that they recover? The differences are kind of slight, but important. This is, if I force people to take this drug, irrespective of who they are they going to recover? So now, for example, we got rid of the problem of the confounding factor of wealth or income. And then one step above this are counterfactuals, which talk about a single patient. So here's a single patient. I have their medical records, and I know that I did not give this drug to the patient, and they had not recovered. So I can ask the question, had I given this particular patient the drug 2 weeks ago before he died, would he have recovered from the disease? So you're no longer asking questions about a population, you're asking a question about an individual or an individual case. And then try to imagine alternative ways things could have turned out for that particular instance. And as we will see, these type of questions are kind of, in a way, the most complicated questions we ask in causal inference. This is from Julia Pearl's book, which he calls the ladder of causal inference. So he puts this on three rungs of the ladder. So the association questions, which were the most basic ones, can I predict the value of Y from X, are at the lowest rung. And then if you start asking intervention questions, you kind of have to climb this ladder. You have to do a little bit more work. And then counterfactuals are at the top rung. These are the most complex things, and they require the most complex or most complicated machinery to actually answer these sorts of questions. So this is sort of a general introduction for what sort of problems we're going to look at. And as I promised, I wanted to go through Simpson's paradox. And the numbers that I show here are actually from a paper, but I'm pretty sure that it appeared in a lot of different papers. I copy-pasted them from Leon Buteau's paper, which I'm going to talk about later. So here is the situation. And I promised you no healthcare examples, but this is kind of a healthcare example anyway. Let's say that we have a hospital and we have two kinds of treatments for kidney stone disease. You have treatment A, which is some sort of minimally invasive procedure. And then you have treatment B, which is like a surgery, like you actually cut up the patient and do something. And then we can look at what is the recovery rate. So you can have positive or negative outcomes. And we look at what is the rate of positive outcomes for these two different treatments. And we see that for minimally invasive treatments, 78% of patients recover, but for this invasive treatment, 83% of the patients recover. I might have swapped which one is the invasive, which one is the non-invasive. It doesn't matter, like two different treatments. So can I now conclude that treatment B is preferable? More patients recover who get treatment B, so should I even bother doing treatment A at my hospital? Why don't I just do treatment B all the time? By the way, can I ask who already knows about Simpson's paradox? About half. And then plus all the shy people who wouldn't put up their hands. Who does not know about Simpson's paradox? Who would find an explanation of it useful? Okay, so there is sufficient number of people to justify this. Okay, so so we would see that on if we look across the entire patient population of the hospital, treatment B looks like a better treatment than treatment A. However, now we're going to break down the data to patients who have a small kidney stone and patients who have a large kidney stone. And this is the same patients, we just group them according to the size of their kidney stone, and we see that if you have a small kidney stone, then treatment A gives you a much higher chance of recovery. But if you have a large kidney stone, treatment A also gives you a much higher chance of recovery. So what's going on? How can treatment A be the good treatment for if you have a small kidney stone, and treatment A be the good treatment if you have a large kidney stone, but then overall treatment B being preferable? This kind of doesn't make sense, and this is why it's called a paradox. I don't know what questions I can ask the audience to kind of try and solve this problem together, so I'm just going to talk through it. What is the catch here? The catch is, if you look at these numbers, so I didn't tell you what these numbers are, this is the recovery rate, this is the number of actual recovered positive patients, and this is the overall number of patients who received this treatment in this condition. And what you're going to see is that for patients with small stone, this is probably flipped, sorry. With patients with small stone, the doctors overwhelmingly favor treatment B. But patients with small stone are more likely to recover. These are the easy cases. So treatment B is more likely to be prescribed in the easy cases, whereas treatment A is more likely to be prescribed in the more difficult cases, in the large stone. So if you have a large stone, chances are 263 people got treatment A and only 80 got assigned treatment B. So if you don't know this and you just look at the averages, you would see that treatment B is associated with a higher recovery rate, but that's only because it's given the easy cases to solve. Most of the time that treatment B is applied, it's actually applied on the easy cases anyway, and most of the time treatment B is applied, it's applied on the hard cases. And if you don't know this, if you don't do this breakdown by the kidney stone size, you will actually draw the wrong conclusions from this data. So that's basically it. So now I have a question to ask the audience, which is, now that I've told this story, now that you've seen this data, and you're the data scientist of the hospital, whatever, and you take this to the doctors, can you now conclude that treatment A should be used more often than treatment B? Is that a valid conclusion? Who thinks that it's a valid conclusion now? Put your hands up. Everybody put your hands up. Everybody, like, just put your hands up. Okay? Please. Okay. Leave your hands up if you think that treatment A is a better treatment than treatment B. And you should be recommending treatment A. It's about like 10, 12 hands. Not everybody put up their hands, unfortunately. Who thinks that it still would be an invalid conclusion? Who thinks that we cannot conclude that treatment A is better than treatment B? Many people. Okay, so you put your hands up first. Can you give a reason why you think it's not? Treatment A is a good choice if the only thing it depends on is how big the kidney stone is? Is that the point? You would recommend treatment A only if you have a smaller stone. But why would you recommend treatment B to people who have a larger stone? If you have a larger stone, with treatment B you have only a 69% of recovery, but with treatment A you still have a higher rate of recovery, it seems. So it still seems that no matter if you have a small stone or you have a large stone, within this comparison, the marginal success rate of treatment A is always better than treatment B. So I personally see no reason why you would recommend treatment B to patients with large stone. But there is another possible answer to why you would not think that this is good. Who else wants to give an? Yes. Okay, so it might depend. Okay, if I understand the question, or understand the answer was, it might depend on the condition of the patients who are unable to recover. Sure, like I'm just classifying them as positive and negative recovery, but if negative recovery from one of the treatments is more crippling than the other, then obviously that's a reason to choose. Let's assume that is the same. Let's assume that there is, like, the negative consequences of both of the treatments are equally bad. So there is no reason to distinguish on that basis. Answer.
So we were able to flip the which treatment we preferred by conditioning on.
Yes.
Stone. What happens if there's something else we could condition on?
That's the answer that I expected. Yes. So we were able to flip the direction of preference by conditioning on small stone. So this you can think of this operation of splitting the data into two groups as conditioning on a variable. So the point was, what if there is another variable that we can now condition on? So we can split these columns further into two smaller columns, and the relationship flips once again. So for example, what happens if doctors take into account not just the size of the kidney stone, but also body mass index, for example? And if you now take into account body mass index, you can potentially see another reversal effect. So, to summarize it in the language of causal inference, these conclusions are valid under the assumption there are no further confounding factors. If kidney stone size is the only thing, only confounding factor, then you're done. But there's always the slight chance that you were missing something else. So you have to ask the doctor, like, what are the other things that you take into account in assigning patients to different treatments? So what is a confounder? Bernard has talked about this and drew these diagrams. We can kind of reason about how the different variables that we can measure influence each other. There are three variables here. There's the kidney stone size, the treatment, which is which treatment is assigned to the patient, and the outcome, which is did they recover, have they not recovered. And the size of the kidney stone influences both the treatment, the selection of the treatment, and it has an influence on the positive outcomes as well. And of course, there is a direct relationship between treatment and outcome, or at least we hope that different treatments will have a different effect on different patients. And the problem is caused by this general idea that when you observe the association between treatment and outcome, so if you just look at this, you're measuring how the treatment is associated with the positive outcome. When you do that, this association will have two separate components. It's going to be a mixture of two sources of statistical dependency. One source is going to describe basically the statistical dependency that's induced by this actual causal relationship between treatment and outcome. And then the second component is going to be what we call a spurious association, an association induced by the confounder. So these two things can end up being related to each other, and there can be a statistical association between treatment and outcome, not because one is causally related to one another, but because they both are influenced by a common hidden factor. And the problem is that if you just look at the joint distribution of treatment and outcome, you won't be able to disambiguate between these two sources of statistical dependence. This is why confounding is a problematic problem. This observed association, you can describe it as P of Y given X. What is the probability of outcome conditioned on treatment? What is the probability of recovery among the patients that have been assigned treatment A? The causal association, as we will see, is described by this object that Bernard already introduced and defined, which is this do calculus notation, P of Y given do X, which is what is the probability of recovery given that I actually actively assign the treatment to this patient, irrespective of their other features. If you ran a completely randomized trial, which means that you assign the different treatments completely randomly to individuals, irrespective of the size of their kidney stone and all other measurable things, the associations you would see would be this. But because that's not the case, because you have this edge here, people are not randomly assigned, you observe this. And these two things are not generally the same. That's the whole idea about causal inference. Another way to think about it is color coding the edges as to what they actually describe. The red edge describes what I call the hospital's policy. This is something that the hospital or the doctor decides. How am I going to assign people to different treatments given my observations of the kidney stone size? So this edge describes what's going on in the doctor's mind. Whereas the blue arrows correspond to, they describe human, how the human body reacts to different treatments. How this describes human physiology. And this is why causal inference is important, because if my analysis results in a recommendation that I make to the doctor, that's going to change the red arrow. I'm changing how the doctor operates, therefore I change the red arrow here. But it won't change human physiology. Like if I tell the doctor, prefer treatment B over treatment A, this edge is going to be different, but the blue edge is going to be exactly the same. Human physiology doesn't change based on what the doctors decide to do, or at least we can assume. This is the independence idea that Bernard talked about, independence of mechanisms. So I now color-coded these different things that I had in mind based on which edges contribute to these quantities. If I studied the causal association P of Y given do X, that is described by this arrow alone, and this is therefore only blue. The red arrow does not influence this quantity. If I look at the spurious correlation, this spurious correlation is induced by the presence of the confounder. One of these arrows is red, one of the arrows is blue. So this spurious correlation, if I change the red arrow, is going to change the spurious correlation term. If the doctor changes how they operate, I'm going to now see a different statistical dependence between the variable as a result of this. But this term is robust under such change. This term remains the same no matter what process the doctor uses to allocate people to treatments. This is an invariant quantity that's invariant with respect to changing the red arrow. But this thing, which is what we often model in machine learning, P of Y given X, is actually sensitive to changes in that red thing. And this tells you about the context that one of the goals of causal inference is to find these sort of more universal rules that remain unchanged under changing conditions in the environment. Whereas your conclusions based on this will change. So for example, if you run the same analysis in a different hospital, your conclusions about the effectiveness of these different treatments would change, even if it's carried out by the same people, only because different patients are allocated to different treatments. So I wanted to remind you also of the confounder adjustment formula that Bernard talked about. So this is the general confounding diagram. You have X and Y. You might have some direct causal link between X and Y, but you have this Z variable, which is the confounder. I think you also call it Z in South Africa, so I'm going to be British about it. So this Z influences both X and Y. And if you wanted to isolate the direct causal effect of X on Y, then you would calculate this P of Y given do X using this adjustment formula. Bernard showed this on Monday or Tuesday, I don't know. So you would take the conditional distribution of the outcome conditioned on both the confounder and the treatment. So you have to condition on Z. And then you average these conditional distributions over the marginal distribution of the confounder. So if this is difficult to understand, it's easier if you show what the conditional distribution would look like. So you can decompose the conditional distribution by just using Bayes' rule and whatever rules of probability distributions, and that would take this form. And notice that the difference is that that the conditional distribution depends on the conditional distribution of z given x, which is a property of the joint distribution between the confounding variable and x. Whereas in the adjustment formula, you don't depend on this joint distribution. You only depend on the marginal distribution of z. So if I do the color coding again, p of z is just a marginal distribution of kidney stone size. It's not related to either the hospital's policy or human. It's kind of related to human physiology, but not. It's sort of independent from recovery. So I colored it black. This thing is the probability of recovery given the kidney stone size and the treatment. This is described purely by the blue edges. Whereas in this conditional distribution, you have this part which relates to this, which relates to the policy. So the conditional distribution of y given x is going to be sensitive to the policy that the doctor is using, whereas the intervention conditional, this do stuff, is invariant under the policy. So that's sort of an important aspect here. So I don't think I have anything more to say about Simpson's paradox, but basically this is how you can understand Simpson's paradox from confounding, and this is what you can do with it. And when we broke down the formula, the data by columns, by kidney stone size, effectively, that was like a way of applying the adjustment formula, because you essentially conditioned on the confounder. Question? Yes. I understand your question, so I'll just repeat it. So the observation was that the direction of this term is in the should point, right? This is something that goes from x to z, but the arrow is from z to x. Is that? Yes, so that's true, but then you can use Bayes' rule on this formula, and then you're gonna get this edge. I didn't want to like overcomplicate it, but the short answer to your question is that you can further refactor this formula via the Bayes' rule, and then you explicitly get this edge here. Good observation, thank you. Further questions?
Yeah, it's on the same conclusion of that. Is there any reason we use Bayes' rule to reverse the statistical dependency in P of Z and X?
I don't know how to answer that question. The question is there any reason here is just how it works out. This formula is very easy to obtain with like two lines of math. I didn't want to put it here because then I have to go and explain it, and then it takes time. So the point that I wanted to make is that this, if you just model the conditional distribution, it's going to be tainted by the policy that's used by the hospital. But if you try to estimate this, this is something invariant. Even if the hospital changes their practice, your conclusions are still going to be valid under those changing assumptions. So this is a quiz, and there's going to be three scenarios of like you're a data scientist working here doing this thing, whatever. Do you need to calculate P of Y given do X, or do you need to calculate P of Y given X? The answer to this question is not trivial. It's not like we always want this, we never want this. It depends on the application. In some applications, it's fine to model P of Y given X. In some applications, you have to be careful and do causal inference, which amounts to essentially calculating this thing. So I want to kind of do this quiz, whether you can detect the situations in which you think causal inference is important. So first scenario, you are the doctor, or you're the hospital, the data scientist working at a hospital. You look at the data, you do the analysis, and your goal is to improve the decision-making around which treatments to give to the patients. So this is why you're doing it, and you fit a model, and then you want to give that model to doctors and say, this is what the data said you should do from now on. Do you need this? Do you want to do causal inference? Or do you need this? Do you want statistical inference? So put your hands up if you think you need causal inference in this instance. And don't look at the people who gave presentations earlier who sit next to you. Okay? I didn't count. Who thinks that you're fine with just doing statistical inference in this case? Nobody. Great. Amazing. No irresponsible people. And so the reason why you need this, as I explained, because you are actually, your goal is to change how the hospital operates. So you're going to change the red arrow. So you want your conclusions to hold up under that policy change. And this is why you need the 2x. Second scenario, and I'm going to speed things up. You work at an insurance company. And this insurance company develops an insurance product that is given to patients who undergo treatment too. Let's say that an insurance product like this exists. I've been diagnosed with kidney stone and I'm assigned treatment too. I go to this insurance company and I buy an insurance product from them. And the way insurance products are priced is that you need to be able to estimate the probability that I'm actually going to die, which is when they give me my family all the money. So they can set the price of the product. The more likely it is that I die, the more expensive the insurance product should be, because the higher the likelihood that they will have to pay my family. Okay, so who thinks that you have to use causal inference in this case? One? Two? Okay. Who thinks that you're fine estimating just P of Y given X? The majority of people. Okay. So, Sebastian, why do you think you need causal inference in this case? Okay, so. Okay, so you can assume that the hospital does not change their policy ever. And the insurance product can assume that the hospital's policy is going to be the same. Yes, it's a big assumption. Under the assumption that the hospital doesn't change their policy, the only thing we need to be able to know is what is the probability of this patient dying. And that can be because they had a large kidney stone, or that can be because the hospital's policy was such that they were assigned to the wrong treatment and they shouldn't have been. In any case, the only thing you want to know is you want to be able to predict a future event from an observation, which is this patient has been assigned treatment too. So now I can look at in what fraction of cases did patients survive who were given treatment to. By the way, these questions probably don't have a yes or no answer. So I'm glad that Sebastian sampled from the other side of the possibilities. You can always make these more complicated and you can always kind of do. But the point is, if you're a passive observer and you just want to be to say something about a system without actually ever intervening, under the assumptions that nothing changes when you have to make the predictions, it's fine to just do P of Y given X. Third scenario, you're a scientist. You're a researcher. You want to understand kidney stone disease. And, you know, or maybe you're a medical scholar and you want to understand how these different treatments could be improved. Do scientists have to worry about causal inference? Who thinks yes in this case? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10-ish, 15. Who thinks that no, for scientists it's fine to ignore causal inference and just do P of X given Y given X, just like the insurance product? One person. Okay. I don't think that this has an answer to it. There are in fact a lot of scientific studies that only concern themselves with associations. And it's fine because you can't always do this. You can't always identify the causal mechanisms behind things, in especially in biology. But you then have, when you publish it or when you tell people about it, you have to caveat it that this was not a causal study. I observed this association between this measurable thing and that other measurable thing. Maybe this indicates some kind of causal relationship between those two variables, but we can't be sure. It's still valuable to have these kinds of insights, but if you have these kinds of insights in science, those are kind of where the real scientific breakthroughs typically could come from, especially in like biology and medicine. All right. Okay. I promise you not just healthcare examples. So here's another example, advertising. You have two advertisements on online, say Coca-Cola or Pepsi or something like that. I probably shouldn't name companies, so these are imaginary Coca-Cola-like company and imaginary Pepsi-like company. And this is, again, numbers are taken from Leon Buteau's paper, but I'm massively abusing these numbers to illustrate a different thing, so it's not exactly the same example he showed. So you have a search engine, and in search engines you have these different slots. Before the real search results show up, you can show these fake search results, which are advertisements sponsored by companies. I think everybody knows this, except if you have an ad blocker and you've never seen those things. And I see that ad A results in a 6.2% click-through rate, and ad B results in a 7.5% click-through rate, which means that if it's shown 2,000 times, then you're going to get more clicks on ad B than you get more clicks on ad A. Can you conclude that ad B is there for a better ad, or people are more interested in ad B than ad A? And the way I phrase this question makes it obvious that the answer is, of course, no. You can, again, do this breaking down thing. You can break it down by ad position. So I said that there are multiple slots in which advertisements can occur. So there's a difference between whether it appears in position one, which is right at the top of the search results page, or position two, which is the second sponsored search results. And you will see that the second sponsored search result page gets overall a lot fewer clicks. People are much more likely to probably accidentally click on the ad on position one than on position two. However, you now see this reversal effect again, where advertisement A does better in position one, and ad A also does better in position two. So can you now conclude that ad A is a better ad than ad B? Answer is the same as before, it depends. Like if the position of the ad describes your problem in full complexity, then probably it's fine to conclude that ad A is actually better than ad B. In like for like comparison. But if there are other things that you haven't modeled, like time of the day, for example, then this might not be valid. Is the position a confounding variable? Who thinks it is a confounding variable? Who thinks that position is a confounder? Some people. Okay, so again, the story is we have these ads, we are the search engine. We put those ads on different positions in the search engine page, and then people see them and click on them. After this story, who still thinks it's a confounder? Well, obviously, I threatened you. So it's not a confounder, actually. It's a different kind of variable called a mediator variable. Remember that if it was a confounder, then the arrow would go in this direction. Display position would influence the content of the ad or the identity of the ad. And it's in fact the other way around. We are the ad the search engine company. We look at the ad features and we determine the display position from based on the content of the ad. So this causal arrow is reversed. In this situation, actually, P of Y given X corresponds to P of Y given do X. And you can verify this in the graph because you see that all the causal links, all the direction of the arrows points from advertisements to click through. There is no confounding factor. There is nothing else. However, there is still something else going on that you have to be kind of conscious of when you deal with this sort of data. The observed association, the statistical dependency between the identity of the ad and the click-through rate, which is this stuff, is composed of two independent sources. There is a direct causal effect, which is that, you know, this ad might be genuinely more interesting to people. This corresponds to this arrow. And then there is an indirect causal effect, which is the content of the ad can have a secondary effect on click-through because the search engine might decide to show a certain ad in certain positions, and certain positions are more visible, therefore they will have an effect on click-through probability. And why is this decomposition relevant, or when is this decomposition relevant? If you are the search engine company, and again, we can color code this graph based on the based on who controls the edges. The ad company or internet company controls this policy, like how do I allocate ads to different display positions, whereas these blue arrows correspond to user behavior. Are you going to click on an ad if you see it in a certain position and it's about a certain thing? The ad company cannot change this, or at least not in the short term. So if your goal as a machine learning company or advertising company is to improve the policy, if you improve how you place the ads in certain positions, your job is to change this red arrow. And this is why when you kind of now color code these different effects, you have to know that there is no way I can change the direct causal effect. If this year's Coca-Cola ad just turns out to be terrible and nobody clicks on it, it doesn't matter what I do with my policy, no one's going to click on it, for example. But the indirect causal effect is the stuff that your policy influences. So if you want to control the situation, which means you want to include click-through rates, it's important for you that you can differentiate between these two kinds of causal effects. Because one path you have control over, the other path you have no control over changing. So we've talked about confounders. You know, if you have three variables, X, Y, and Z, the pattern that you will see that the variable in the middle, and then there are arrows pointing outwards. It's a hidden common cause, and it introduces spurious associations. We talked about these mediator variables. It's called mediator because it mediates the causal relationship between the two variables, for those of you who are kind of familiar with that term. And this can go either way. Like a mediator variable, obviously, is just about arrows passing through Z from X to Y, but they can be arrows passing through Z from Y to X. And the interesting problems here are disambiguating between direct and indirect causal effects. And so if you have three variables, there's obviously more ways you can orient the edges. Each of these edges can point in either directions. So you have 2x2, 4 possible cases. And of course, there is a fourth case, which is colliders. When you have Z, which is a variable that's jointly influenced by both X and Y. And this is going to do something weird. So who knows about explaining away? Who knows what explaining away is? Who has heard the term before? It's not that many people, but I think people are getting tired. Who does not know about explaining away? Who would benefit from an explanation? Great, okay. So here's an example that is somewhat too true and too close to my to home, so that it might be a little bit painful to talk about. So, collider, this is a collider situation. You have two independent variables, coding ability, people skills. And then you have a variable that is influenced by both, which is hiring decisions. So imagine a situation where we are interviewing engineers and we can measure their coding ability in a coding test. And we can measure their people skills, which is how well this person communicates with other people. How, you know, are they a team player? And at the end of the day, we give a score on coding ability and we give a score on people skills. And then we make a hiring decision if the sum of the scores is high enough. And that's our hiring decision. You can assume that in the general population, it's probably not the case, but let's assume that in the general population, if you pick a random person from the street and measure their coding ability and measure their people skills, those are going to be statistically independent from each other. There's no relationship between those two. Let's assume that this is the case. If you now condition on the hiring decision, you now look only in the population that you hired. Within that subpopulation, you're going to see a negative correlation between them. Why? Because if you have a high coding ability, that high coding ability explains the decision that we hired you. If you have high coding ability, you don't have to be good at talking to people. We're still going to hire you, and vice versa. So in the population of people we hired, we're actually going to see an artificial negative correlation between the two qualities. And this is why most of the best software engineers also turn out to be jerks, because, you know, we kind of selected for either of these qualities, and so you see this negative correlation. But it doesn't mean that in the general population, good coders are always jerks. It's just due to the fact that you're looking into the population of people that you hired. Question?
Yeah, but what happens if you select for both?
If you select for both, you select...
I will only hire really good at coding and
good luck. You're not going to hire anyone. But jokes aside, the question was, what happened if we kind of, instead of an or relationship, like a sum, you have an AND relationship? And the answer is, if you have an OR relationship, it's kind of a very clear story. It introduces a negative correlation. If you have an AND relationship, it still introduces a statistical dependency between the variables that isn't there in the general population, but it can be either a positive or a negative correlation at that point. You can't really tell. This is the story that I had. A good question. The point is, whenever you condition on a collider that depends on both of these things, you're now going to see a spurious correlation between these two things that's only there because you conditioned on this variable. So I'm going to show you a toy example on this collider bias. So let's say that X is coding ability, whatever. I draw that from a Gaussian distribution. I wish this was true, that coding ability follows a Gaussian distribution. It's not true. And then people skills Y also follows a Gaussian distribution for sake of argument, and they are independent of each other. And now I have this arbitrary rule for hiring people, which is 3 times X plus 3 times Y. If it's larger than 1.5, then I'm going to hire this person with a high probability. This is like a logistic regression formula. And so this is what the picture looks like. If you look at the joint distribution of X and Y, then of course they are there. You see no correlations. You can see the Pearson correlation is low, and you have a low p-value. You probably can draw more samples, and you will see it statistically significantly. But if what happens if I now condition on the sum of these two variables being high, essentially I'm now only looking at this part of the space, stuff that's kind of high on both of the values. And if I do this, this is the joint distribution of X and Y conditioned on Z being 1. You can see that there is now a negative correlation between the two variables. And this is the picture you have to have in mind. Like, if you have a nice uncorrelated distribution, if you cut off everything but this part, then that's going to look negatively correlated. Okay, so you ask the question, okay, this is easy. Just don't condition on a collider and you're fine. Why would you ever condition on a collider if it introduces these spurious correlations? The answer to that is that we are not always aware that we've conditioned on a collider. Think about this. Every time you do machine learning, think of your analysis as being conditioned already on each individual data point being selected to be in your data set. If you selected your data set completely at random, then if that selection into the data set is completely unrelated to your features, then you're fine, because then there is no collider situation. But if the selection variable, the indicator variable of being selected is a collider, then in your data set you will see spurious correlations introduced by collider bias. So in ML, we always assume that we sampled IID from some P of X and Y, but in reality, we are sampling from P of X and Y conditioned on this data point being observable to us. And if O is this binary variable, which is whether we can observe the data point, if O is independent of X and Y, then you can just ignore it. So this assumption is fine. But if O turns out to be a collider, then you have a problem. Then you have to be aware that there is statistical dependencies in your data set that doesn't actually hold up in the general population. And this is called various names. These are generally called sampling biases. So you have availability bias, which is there is this song in Hungary which goes like this. It's sort of borderline sexist, but it's from my childhood. It's sexist because it talks about women specifically. It's not really. It says, the problem is that women are either beautiful or they are smart, or they are, the problem is that women are either ugly or they are dumb, or if they happen to be beautiful and smart at the same time, they won't talk to me. So this is sort of availability bias, which is if you consider only the samples that are available to you to measure, then you basically condition on availability, so you have collider biases. I should have just skipped this example. But I found it hilarious when I remember this like lyrics. It's in Hungarian, so nobody has to worry. I remember these lyrics and I said, aha, this is availability bias. There's a song in Hungary about it. Survivorship bias, and it has many other names. All right, so these are the basic cases for these diagrams. In reality, causal diagrams look very complicated, or can look very complicated. This is from the Buteau paper that I had a bunch of other things from, and I'm going to maybe talk about this tomorrow. So you can imagine all sorts of situations, and then you can analyze what different problems you might be seeing in the data. Now I'm going to talk about interventions. Here is how I think about this thing in the first place. When you move from normal statistics to causal statistics or causal inference, you increase the granularity by which you describe the world. If you do statistics, you only care about the joint distribution of data, then you have this granularity. If you pair that joint distribution with a corresponding causal diagram, not only do I know how statistically related the variables are, but I also make assumptions about what causes what, I suddenly have a much more granular description of all the possible models of the world. Many different joint distribution causal diagram pairs can correspond to the same joint distribution. Consequently, if you have a causal diagram, you can start asking questions that the joint distribution representation is just too coarse to address. And then it turns out, I'm going to talk about this, there is an even more fine-grained description of the world when we actually consider a full structural equation model. Another way you can think about this is that if you consider the set of all questions that these different paradigms can answer, if you only have a joint distribution, you can answer the blue questions. If you now consider a joint distribution together with a graph, you can suddenly ask questions in this green region, which you couldn't ask before. And if you have a fully specified structural equation model, then you can ask the yellow questions. So intervention is about, this part is about what are the types of questions we can answer if I have a joint distribution and a graph. So here is the toy example that I came up with, and it's actually part of the practical tomorrow. I give you a normal distribution, and I ask each of you to write a Python script to sample from that normal distribution. Very likely, people are going to come up with different solutions because there is no unique solution to this problem. So maybe one of you will give me this script, another one of you will give me that script, and a third person will give me that script. Each of these correctly solved the problem samples from the same distribution. If I can't look at your code, only run your code and draw samples from this. So I'm going to look at the distribution of X and Y. I'm going to see that all of these codes, all of these snippets, produce the same joint distribution. So if this is the only thing I can do, if I can look at the joint distribution of the data that comes out of your script, I won't be able to tell the difference between these three different scripts. They are going to look identical to me. Here is, and this is fine, like so long as you only want to reason about the joint distribution of data is fine. But if you now want to predict what's going to happen, if I intervene to the execution of this script in a particular way, you are now in trouble. So let's say that I'm a hacker, and I can hack the Python interpreter that you use to run your code so that after every line you execute, I can insert a line of my own. So after you execute one line of your code, I can execute my code, and then your next line of code and my code. And I'm just going to say, I really want the variable x to be 3. I want to fix the variable to be 3. So every time you execute a code, I execute another code saying, set the value of x back to 3. So let's say that I'm a hacker and I interfere with the system this way. And I do this on all three of these scripts. So the consequence is that no matter what you do in your code, you will not be able to change the value of x, because if you change it, I immediately set it back to 3. This is sort of one way to explain interventions in this space. Are these going to be behaving the same way after I made this intervention? Of course, the answer is no. This is what I'm going to see if I sample from this intervene system. Notice that this is x. And all the points are now lined up around x equals 3, because I set x to be 3. So nothing else is possible. So this looks like a line. It's actually a bunch of points lined up around the line. And then I can look at the marginal distribution of y's, which looks like this. It has a mean around 5 and some standard deviation. Who thinks the green stuff, if I now run the green code with this intervention, who thinks it's going to look like the blue one? Who thinks it's going to be different? Lots of people. Yes, it's going to be different. This was the easy question. There's going to be a more difficult question. It's going to be different. These two models no longer look identical. Whilst their behavior without intervention was identical, under intervention they behave differently, which is the crucial part. Now, who thinks that the red stuff is going to look more like the blue stuff? I'm not going to give you enough time to figure this out. So red equals blue. Who thinks that? A couple people. Red is like green. Who thinks that? Nobody. Red is something completely new that's unlike green or blue. A couple people think that. It actually looks like the green one, which is funny because nobody expected that, but I didn't give you enough time to figure this out. The red one behaves the same way as the green one. And we're going to see why that's the case. And another way to kind of plot this is, instead of looking at the joint distribution of x and y, because I set the value of x to 3, it doesn't really make sense to plot a scatter plot anymore. So I'm just going to look at this distribution of y's. And I see that the blue thing gives me a distribution of y that's centered around 4 or 5. And the red and the blue thing actually line up on top of each other perfectly. And by the way, obviously, because the joint distribution of x and y under no intervention, this is under no intervention, are the same, if I simply calculate the conditional of y given x, the three models are going to do exactly the same thing. Now, due to the sloppy way that I sampled this, there is a little bit of kind of estimation error, but believe me that these three curves are basically the same. You can tell those things apart, but under intervention, they work differently. If you only have access to the joint distribution, you won't be able to predict that these different scripts will work differently under intervention. The whole point of causal inference is observing that if you give me not just the ability to sample from your model, not just the joint distribution, but you also draw the corresponding causal diagram on a piece of paper and give it to me, these two things together, the joint distribution plus the causal diagram, I can now use this combination of information to predict how these different things are going to behave under intervention. So the extra knowledge of the causal diagram gives me that superpower of predicting things that I wasn't able to predict before. But my predictions are only going to be correct if your causal diagram actually describes reality perfectly. So yes, if you add causal graphs to data versus just data alone, you can now predict behavior under intervention. I have 15 minutes left. So the lesson so far, usually machine learning we deal with the join distribution. That's the granularity of description of the world that we care about. For example, supervised learning approximates P of Y given X, which is related to the join distribution. If I give you the join distribution, you can just compute this, nothing simple. However, we've seen that just the join distribution obscure certain details about the data generation process. It doesn't give you the source code of those Python functions. It just gives you samples from it. And you won't be able to make different predictions about different source codes that would result in the same thing. The join distribution alone does not allow you to predict effects of interventions. And what you want is this P of Y given do X, which is the distribution of Y under intervening and setting the variable x to a certain value. P of y given x and P of y given do x sometimes coincide, like we see in the mediator variable case, they would coincide. But in the confounder case, they don't coincide. By consequence of these, there are multiple different P of y given do x's that can be consistent with the same join distribution. So if you wanted to find this P of Y given do X from the join distribution, it's actually an underspecified problem or an ill-posed problem. There are multiple different solutions. The solutions depend on which way the causal diagram is organized. And so in order to solve such problems, in order to figure this thing out from the join distribution, we need to add some additional constraints. Just the join distribution doesn't constrain the problem sufficiently. We need to add extra constraints. And we will see that those extra constraints are captured in the causal diagram. So if you add the causal diagram to the mix as a way to constrain your problem, then that together with the join distribution will allow you to solve this problem uniquely under some situations. Here's roughly how this goes, and this explains do calculus. This is what we do in ML usually. You have some observable join distribution. I draw this factor graph. If you know what it is, great. If you don't know what it is, you don't have to worry about it. This is just a cartoon representation of a black box that I can sample from. I can sample training data from this black box. This is training data here. As many as I want, IID, several samples. This observable joint has a property, which is the conditional distribution of y given x. If you give me the joint, mathematically, I can compute this conditional. What we do in supervised machine learning is basically, I have training data. How do I construct a model, q of y given x, with some parameter? Maybe this is a big neural network where theta are the parameters that approximates the observational conditional, so the conditional that corresponds to the observed distribution. We all know how to do this. You know, TensorFlow tutorial will probably cover this case. This is not difficult. The question now is, what if this is not the object we want to approximate, but we want to approximate this causal quantity, this P of Y given do X? What if our problem is such that this is what we need? Can we build a model, another neural network for sake of argument, q of y given x and theta, that instead of approximating this, it approximates this other thing? If I could sample from this join distribution, which is the join distribution I would see if I intervene to the system, this is the join distribution I would see if I ran a randomized controlled experiment in the kidney stone example. But what if I can't run the randomized experiment? Can I still approximate this quantity using training data from this distribution? If I have access to this distribution, the problem is trivial. But if I cannot simulate the effect of intervention, can I still say something about that intervention from just the data that I already have, which is under the non-intervention case? This is the whole part of causal inference, is how do you make predictions about interventions using observational data, just normal data sampled from under normal conditions, not intervention conditions. So you want to somehow create a bridge from this thing so that you can get an estimate of that thing. And this bridge is going to be formed by the causal model. You can notice that this observable joint distribution is not a sufficient description of the world. You need to go one level up, and you need to add extra constraints to the problem. So up here, we have the joint distribution, plus we also have the causal diagram. So now I know not just that these three variables are statistically related, but now I also know that there's a fourth variable that's a hidden variable, and I also know the direction of causal relationships between these guys. And in such causal model, I can simulate the effect of interventions. Simulating the effect of interventions on, say, this variable corresponds to what is usually called mutilation on the graph, which means that you take all the edges that point into that node and you cut them out of your graph. So instead of this node being causally influenced by this hidden variable as before, you just set its value to a particular value. So this is the causal diagram that corresponds to the hypothetical situation when you intervene and set the variable to a certain value. This causal model also induces some joint distribution over variables. I plotted this. I actually simulated the intervention in the Python code example, and those were the distributions that were scattered around the line or exactly on a line. So this green distribution would be those things. And that green distribution will have a conditional distribution. And this conditional distribution is what I call an intervention conditional. So instead of looking at the conditional distribution in this observed distribution, you look at the conditional distribution in this imagined joint distribution, which is a joint distribution you would see if you actually intervened. And if your causal diagram describes reality well, then this joint distribution is actually going to correspond to the intervention join. And this intervention conditional is actually going to correspond to the thing that you wanted to calculate in the first place. I don't put equation marks here. I put an approximation thing to say that if your causal diagram is wrong, then these things are not going to correspond. These are only going to correspond if you got your causal assumptions correct, and many other things. But now we've created a bridge from this thing that we can sample from to this thing which we want to estimate. The question is, what is this object and how can I calculate it, or how can I estimate it from data? And this is where do-calculus comes in. I'm not going to explain do-calculus, but just know that do-calculus allows you to turn this green formula, which is what the conditional distribution and this intervention scenario would be, and express it in terms of various marginals and conditional distributions of this observable distribution. So all of these are now blue, which means that all of these I can estimate from training data. So the naive way of evaluating, so this formula was obtained by applying rules of do-calculus until you turn this thing to that thing. But now all of the distributions that appear in this formula, I can directly estimate from data, and I can calculate this based on my estimates. And if I calculated this based on my estimates, that gives me an estimate of this. And I can use that as the estimate of the thing I wanted to measure. So to show this in the toy example, here's how the additional knowledge of graphs helps. Anyone has any questions on this? One thing that I didn't mention is that this do-calculus, it would have been more appropriate to draw an arrow also from the causal structure, because crucially, this estimable formula, this formula that only contains and the form that it takes depends on the graph structure. If you change the graph structure, you change the assumptions about what causes what, this estimable formula is going to change. Or potentially, you won't be able to find an estimable formula. So toy example for the three scripts. if you now also give me these, I can use do calculus to make predictions about what form this intervention conditional is going to take. So I do the mutilation, which is I cut all the edges that point into x. In this example, x is calculated first and then y. No arrows point into x, so the mutilated graph is the same as the original. And from this, I can conclude that p of y given do x is, p of y given do x is the same as p of y given x. In this second example, I have to cut this edge because it goes into x. That's the mutilation operation. If I intervene on x, I cut all the edges. And now in this mutilated environment, or in this intervention environment, you will observe that now x and y are going to be independent of each other. There's no longer any association between them. And from this, using the rules of do calculus, I can conclude that p of y given do x will correspond to not p of y given x, but just p of y, the marginal distribution of y. And it's actually independent of the value of the intervention. And I can do the same for the third graph. Again, you will observe that there is no direct relationship now between x and y. X is just kind of hanging out in the corner, and z and y are related. But this means that x and y are independent again under the intervention. So I can conclude that in this situation also, p of y given do x corresponds to py. So by just... Yes, question. Yes. So this is a reasoning you do. You don't have any observed data, right? I didn't even tell you that you can sample from these scripts. And you certainly can't look at the source code. You just give me these three graphs. Like one solution uses this, one solution uses that, one third solution uses that. I can predict that in a solution that corresponds to this graph, if I wanted to estimate p of y given do x, I would use this formula. I would just basically calculate p of y given x, and I would be done. So I don't have to do anything special. This is easy to estimate with supervised learning. If I'm in this situation and I want to predict what happens in an intervention, I would have to calculate the marginal distribution of y. I didn't tell you how to actually estimate this. You know, you would fit a GAN or whatever these days. But that's what it says. The graph allows you to relate the quantity that talks about what happens under intervention to the quantity that is just a property of the joint distribution. This you can estimate from data. And to prove this, I actually did this. So if you actually run the experiment, I already showed you these are the conditional distributions that you get. The blue curve behaves differently from the red and the green curve. But here, I actually did do calculus. I have not run the simulation of this intervention. I just looked at data under no intervention, and I used the rules of do calculus, and I plotted the conditional and marginal distributions that do calculus told me I should plot. And I get the correct answer. So the green curve and the red curve, subject to, you know, obviously approximation errors, because I didn't spend a lot of time on making this better, but imagine that if you had more data, these would be exact. So the blue curve and the red curve, the green curve and the red curve have roughly a mean of 1, just like in this case, and the blue curve has a mean of 5, just like in that case. I'm going to overrun a couple minutes, but I'm almost finished. These are the rules of do calculus. I just wanted to scare you. It's very unlikely that you will actually need to be using this in practice. I think it's important that you're aware that they exist. But all you need to know about it is that each of these rules is a rule that you can apply in your derivations of the formula, but they all come with a condition. And this condition is expressed in terms of a graph, a property of the graph. And Bernard talked about deseparation. So these are deseparation conditions. So which of these rules you can apply to any formula depends on whether these properties hold in your graph or not. So if you change your causal graph, you can change which rules of do calculus you can use. And this is, by the way, just a screenshot of this paper, Do Calculus When the True Graph is Known by Hittinen et al. I just Googled and found this. So roughly, I wanted to summarize causal inference by do calculus. Step zero, you have to recognize that you have a causal inference problem. Most of us fail at this stage. Like, don't even recognize that you can't just do supervised machine learning. Step one, you actually have to write down what is the causal query that we want to estimate. Like, do I want P of Y given do X, for example? What is the, do I want to model this intervention? Step two, and these are sort of not in order, you can do it the other way around, you actually have to get a causal graph from somewhere. You have to draw your causal graph. This you can either think of as your assumptions. You know, I know how my system works. You know, when I work with online advertising, engineers build that system. I can draw the causal graph exactly. If you work in biology, then you sometimes have to make assumptions that, you know, this causes that. Bernard talked about causal discovery, which under some conditions allows you to infer the graph from data itself. But he also told you that in general cases, it's not possible. So after this, I know what I want to estimate, and I know the causal graph. Now, I just keep hacking at this equation. So I start from this formula, P of Y given do X. And then I try applying different rules of do calculus and other rules that apply to probability distributions. You can apply Bayes' rule, for example. And some of these rules of do calculus are cool because they reduce the number of do operators in the equation. So this is a do operator. And at some point, when you apply these do calculus operations, you end up with a formula that doesn't have any do operations anymore, that only has your normal variables in it. And that's when you're done. So you basically apply this recursively until you get rid of all the do operations. Questions? Yes. So this is the most general description. Like, so this is you don't have to use the language of do calculus, but it's super useful. And there is this proof that says if you can get to an expression by applying rules of do calculus, then there is no way you can estimate those effects from the data. So it's like you have, it's sort of a completeness result. Sure, you don't have to use this particular notation, but essentially what Bernard did was the same thing. There is probably a corresponding set of rules in do calculus that he followed. He just didn't use this formalism, he used things under the hood. Anyway, I'm running out of time, so I just want to whisk through this. If you can do this, then your problem is not identifiable, which means that under no conditions, even with the causal diagram, you won't be able to tell anything about what happens in that situation of intervention. If this is the case and you really want to know the answer to that question, you have to change the experiment that you're running. You may have to actually run a randomized control trial, and that might be the only way you can estimate the effect. Step four is the interesting one, which is where the actual machine learning starts. Once you know what it is that you wanted to estimate, the stuff with the blue formula with the blue stuff in it, you want to find a smart way to estimate it from a finite sample of data. And so, in a way, when you talk to people who work on causal inference, the problem ends for them, the problem ends here. Like, I know what I need to estimate, the rest is uninteresting. When you talk to machine learning people, this is where the problem begins for them. Like, I don't care about all this, I know how I want to estimate stuff from data. And in reality, you want to kind of marry these things. Both of these are important. You have to know what it is you're estimating, and you have to be good at estimating it from data. And this is where, say, deep learning would come into play, and you know, tricks like variational bounds and everything can come into play. All right, so I want to close with this slide. There are things you can do with joint distributions only, but for example, you cannot predict what happens under intervention. If you, in addition to the joint distribution, you also have a causal graph, then you can now start answering a broader set of questions with your data. And this is basically what causal inference is. This is what do calculus allows you to do, or whatever you call it, do calculus or something else. This is what these techniques allow you to do. broaden the set of questions you can address with your analysis. And I'm going to talk about this outer shell tomorrow, which is going to be counterfactuals. If you have any questions, then we can talk in the coffee breaks and or something. Thank you.